This is the last but one lecture for this course, and we have a very distinguished personality here, Dr. Shekhar Singh. He is the director of the Samia Center for Equity Studies in New Delhi. He is the convener of the National Campaign for People's Right to Information, and he's also a member of the Delhi State Council for the Right to Information. He co-chairs the International Task Force on Transparency based in Columbia University, New York. He has been a teacher for over 30 years, teaching philosophy at St. Stephen's College, University of Delhi, and at the Northeastern Hill University, Shillong, and Ethics and Administration and the Management of the Environment at the Indian Institute of Public Administration, New Delhi. He has also been the director of the Center for Equity Studies, which is an independent think tank. He has also worked with the government and was advisor to the Planning Commission of India, chairperson of various Government of India committees and task forces, and is a commissioner to the Supreme Court of India. Dr. Shekhar Singh.
Thank you very much. It's a privilege to be able to speak to
the Right to Information Act, which, as I'm sure you all know, is one of the newer acts which has come into force from the 12th of October 2005, and I thought this would be a good occasion to discuss it. Now, we have an hour and a half, but I would much rather if this was a discussion, so don't restrain yourself to ask questions to the end. Ask questions as and when you feel, so that we can have a bit of a discussion, because otherwise laws can become a little boring, and I don't want people to sort of forget half the things they wanted to ask. Before I go into the act, let me say that there are two or three very interesting things about this law. First of all, this Right to Information Act is one of those laws which is actually a people's act. In other words, unlike many other laws, this was not a law which was primarily or totally drafted by the government, but was a law which was actually put together by civil society groups and was then taken to the government through the National Advisory Council, and then there was extensive interaction with the government. And finally, the act came through almost, I would say, almost in the same form that it was suggested. Secondly, it is at the moment, unquestionably, the strongest Right to Information Act anywhere in the world. So if you look at the laws which exist in the UK or in the USA or elsewhere, you will find that in most areas, there are one or two areas where this might not be, but overall, it is among the strongest laws that we have. So at least these two things make it a very sort of interesting legislation. And I will, as we go along, try and point out on specific clauses how things have evolved. Now, as I said, it came into effect on 13th of October, 120 days after enactment. This is also interesting because some of you might know that in 2002, the Government of India had enacted a Freedom of Information Act. This act was passed by both houses of parliament. It got presidential assent, but it was never actually notified. And the problem was that the act had a clause in it which said it will come into effect from the date of notification. And the government never notified it, so it just lay dormant for 2 years. So when this act was being formulated, we all learned from that experience, so we did not leave any such clause. And what the act was said was that it will come into effect 120 days after being passed in Parliament. So there was no discretion left on whether it should be notified or not. Another interesting thing here is, and some of you might know this, that UK passed a Freedom of Information Act, which they passed on the 1st of January 2000. But that act came into effect on the 1st of January 2005. In other words, they gave 5 years to their government to prepare for the actual implementation of the act. Of course, newspaper reports suggest that the government used those 5 years very productively in destroying a lot of documents that they didn't want inevitably to come out. But nevertheless, it took 5 years. And we recently had a meeting in Delhi where there were some officials from UK who asked us, how come we gave our government 5 years and you only gave your government 4 months? So my first response, of course, was that our government is far more efficient. We don't need 5 years like your government needs. But the real response was, and this is what has happened, that look, in our government, whether you gave them 5 years, whether you gave them 10 years, the work would finally be done in the last 4 months. So why not get rid of all that and start with that 4 months? And this is what has happened. Even today, we are still setting up information commissions and so on and so forth. So this was one of the important things that happened, which made sure that the act came into effect finally. There are many preparatory clauses which came into effect immediately, and as all of you, most of you probably belong to what we call in the act public authorities, which are government and other such organizations. I'm sure you're aware of the fact that public information officers would have to be appointed and a lot of information put up front before the act came into effect. Now, it has a very wide scope. The act covers the central, state, and local governments, for one. It also covers all bodies owned, controlled, or substantially financed, non-governmental organizations substantially financed, directly or indirectly, by funds provided by the appropriate government. Appropriate government means central government or state government. Now, this is interesting because one of the things this means is that even if you are a private hospital or a private school, but you've got land on concessional rates from the government, then technically you come under this act. And even if you have tax concessions as a class or a category from the government, it would be indirectly support from the government, so you would come under this. The term substantially financed has not been defined in law, but our advice to the government has been, you assume that everybody who gets anything from the government comes under the act, let them appeal and say, no, they don't come under the act. Then we'd be very suspicious. Why don't they want to be transparent? So, you know, it'll be a very difficult thing for people to take up. It covers the executive, the judiciary, and the legislature. In this, it's a very interesting act because most acts across the world do not cover the legislature or the judiciary. They only cover the executive. But this act covers all three. And I must tell you that in the process of negotiating this act, we discovered that every wing of the government wants everybody else to be transparent, but don't want themselves to be transparent. So the judiciary kept pressing for a Right to Information Act, but when they became aware that this act is going to cover them, they were most upset about it. And the same, so it is not something which is easily won, but we thought that it's just fair that all wings of the government be covered by it.
Could I just ask a question?
Yes, of course.
When you say we,
who is we? We the people of India. Well, I'm saying we actually because there was a drafting group which drafted this act. I happened to be a member of that group, so I'm putting it, but it was on behalf of the citizens of India. And when this was negotiated with the government, which I mentioned right in the beginning, and there were detailed discussions, many of these issues were raised. So whenever I keep saying that, I'm really talking about people who are involved in drafting the law, okay? But you could take it any way you like. It includes information relating to private bodies which can be accessed under any other law for the time being enforced. Now, this is important because there has been in the press in recent times a huge debate where, for example, public sector banks have been reported to have said that they have a disadvantage because they are covered under the Act, but private sector banks are not covered under the Act, or so they think, and therefore they would lose customers. Now, my first response is that if I had to put my money in a bank, I would much rather put it in a bank which was transparent so that I knew what was happening to my money than to put it in a bank which is opaque. But that besides, the law as it exists covers the private sector also. Now, the private sector hasn't fully realized this as yet, but what the law says is, and if you look at Section 2F, you will find that in the law, it says that any citizen can ask the government for any information which the government itself can access from any private body under any other law in existence. So, for example, if I want to know what is the who are the shareholders of a particular company, a private company, because under the company's law, the government has the right to get that information, I can ask the government to get that information for me. So, in other words, it covers almost everything. We had a long debate when this act was being formulated among the civil society groups, and there were many people who were of the opinion that we should directly bring the private sector under the act, but on balance it was felt it is better to access the private sector through the government rather than directly, and this I think works very effectively. Now, I'm not going to go through all the definitions, they're the usual things, but I want to just mention two or three which have become somewhat important or interesting. The term information in the Act, among other things, also covers opinions and advices. Now, why this has become interesting is because some of you might have seen in the press that there's been a lot of debate of whether file notings are to be made public under this law or not. And you have the Prime Minister's office coming up with a clarification saying, in effect, that some file notings can be made public and some can't. But you have the Chief Information Commissioner and the Information Commission coming up with a public statement saying, sorry, they're going to follow the law strictly, which says, or which does not bar file notings from being made public. And the Prime Minister or anybody else doesn't have the authority to override the Act. They will have to go and amend the Act. So as the law stands today, the general understanding, and believe me, this is also the understanding within the government, because we've had talks with the minister concerned, and they all agree that they made a mistake and that the law went out allowing access to file notings. But as things stand, you have access. Every citizen has access to file notings. And unless they change the law, that is how it's going to be. And any amount of circulars from the Prime Minister's office cannot get rid of that. There's also this thing about samples, which I underlined. See, one of the criticisms of Right to Information Acts are that they only catch the paper trail. And if you're a smart person, you make sure that the paperwork is all perfect. And therefore, it doesn't really bring out very much. Well, this Act goes beyond that. Under the Right to Information Act, it's not only paper information, but you can also demand samples of things. And this has been used to great effect, I know, in many parts of the country. I know in Delhi, for example, one day a young man walked into my office. He said he was an IIT graduate, a software or a hardware engineer working with a computer firm. And he wanted to ask me if he could use the Right to Information Act, because the road which he used to travel every day to go home, every 3 months it was repaired, and then every 3 months it would get potholes. And he was fed up with it. So I said to him, yeah, under the law you can access a sample. So you ask for a sample of the material, get it analyzed, and if it's not up to specifications, you file a complaint. He asked for a sample, he got a sample. 2 days after he got the sample, the contractor came to his house and said, what is the problem? So he says, the problem is that the road gets pitted. He says, please don't move forward with your sample. I'll make sure you have no complaint after this. Within 15 days, I'm told this contractor on his own expense repaired that stretch of road, and since then, this is some months back, he says he's had no problem. So you have the right to access samples of all sorts of things. Among other things, there is also the right, which is a very interesting right, of inspection of work. So, because you see, the idea is not just that the law is going to help you to catch people after they've done something wrong, because that's a very regressive way of functioning, that, you know, you wait till they do something wrong and then you catch them. So increasingly it's being used by public participating in works as they're going on and wanting to go to sites and saying, okay, show us the work order. Tell us what you're doing. Why are you doing this and not that? And that itself becomes...
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
While on this inspection, in fact, we got some order saying that first half an hour, there will not be any fees. Outwards, for every 15 minutes, some charge is there.
That's an inspection of files.
Yeah, but suppose the information is asked, which also makes us to inspect a lot of books and then make the data available in the required format. For that also, this charge is applicable? Because we are inspecting the document to make the document as he wants.
No, the inspection fees is only for when people want to inspect files. If people within the government have to search out information, there is no fee for that.
Recently, one collector firm asked me to give information for the last 5 years on various purchase orders which have gone on a single form or a proprietary basis. He has given a format also. So I have transferred that under the law to different purchase groups. But that requires a lot of information to be collected, a lot of time to be spent. So how to account for charging for that?
Okay, you won't be able to, but can I suggest that you hold this question, because we'll come to this question.
Sure.
We'll keep it, it's a very important question, we'll keep it in mind. Very soon we'll come to all these problems and then see how we can deal with them. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, there is no barrier to asking information about the past. The only thing is, if information has been legally destroyed, then obviously you can't produce it. So most departments have guidelines that something is kept for 10 years or something is kept for 20 years. So, but any information, even if it is in the past, you can ask for it and get it. Yeah, it does. There is. Yeah, it is. It is. In fact, that's a very good point, because that's exactly what we were told. And so the law has a specific provision that the guidelines relating to the destruction of information are to be reviewed by the Information Commission. And that they have to then agree that this is, because I totally agree with you, I could make a guideline saying every 15 days destroy all information, and I would never give any information, because it takes 30 days, you know, to get information. So this has been provided for in the law. Now, as I said, this inspection bit is important, because you can actually inspect. And let me just tell you, I was speaking in Delhi a little while back to a group of resident welfare associations. And after I had done this presentation, an elderly lady came up to me. And she says, you know, this act has really made my life, changed my life and made me a much happier person. So I thought maybe she'd use the act to access some important information. And as I'm always on the lookout for stories and case studies, I said, tell me. She said, no, I haven't used the act. She says, you know, my husband retired, and he used to sit at home the whole day and make my life miserable. Then he says, one day he went to some lecture and where he heard about this law. Now, every morning he has a bath, he shaves, he gets dressed, he gets onto his scooter, and I ask him, where are you going? He says, I'm going for inspection. And he roams around the city, and wherever he sees any construction work going on, he says, you show me the work order, you show me, where is the junior engineer? He goes, inspects it, he tells him, look, this is not right, this is right, and comes and then tells his friends, you know, I fired him up, I'm going to go back tomorrow and see. Now, here is an example of a person who retired as a clerk in some private sector company, was never empowered all his life. But after retirement, because of this act, he feels empowered. He feels that his tax money, he has a right to go and make sure that it's being properly spent. So it's something which empowers people. And I find that this has become a great help in many places, especially in Delhi, because now contractors are very worried that even when they are making something, they make sure that everything is in shipshape, because there are so many engineers and so many people who know about engineering who are quite willing to, you know, take a stroll every morning or evening and go and look around, and they have the technical expertise to say this is all nonsense. And they have a right today to do that. There are also, you can also take certified samples of material, etc., which I won't go into great detail, but I think you have copies of the act. If not, you can. Now, what is the process? Most of you must already be familiar, but very quickly, you have to submit an application in writing or electronically with a prescribed fee to the public information officer. Now, the government of India has been persuaded to have a very reasonable fee, so their fee is 10 rupees for an application and 2 rupees per page for photocopying. Some state governments have, because every state government has a right to have their own fee. So some have adopted this, but some have put in fees like 50 rupees, 10 rupees for photocopying. The law says that the fees should be reasonable. So there is now a lot of debate about whether a 50 rupee fee for an application is a reasonable fee or not. And this debate will go on. There is a public information officer in each department, agency, in each public authority, etc. There are also assistant public information officers at sub-district levels, and I'll come to this a little more in detail later. But these are all existing officers, so there's no new posts created, it's just a designation of existing officers.
Yes. So precisely this point about existing officers, apparently as it is they are overworked, there is enough load. Now, will it not end up making this man only providing information? He will have no time to attend to his primary job. This can be a very effective way of derailing a functioning office also by vested interest fellows. You just want to decommission them, keep putting requests, because it is existing staff. Unless you create an additional staff, for, especially for this one only. What is your comment?
Well, you know, this is a point which is linked up to a larger point which we'll also discuss, of whether the government is going to get overwhelmed with this act. Our experience has been, and some of you must know, that we've had Right to Information Acts for the last 4 years in certain states. Maharashtra has had a very good act. Delhi has had a reasonably good act. So has Karnataka had a reasonably good act. Rajasthan has had an act. 9 states have had acts. We have found that actually, after the initial excitement, there isn't that much of workload because, and I'll give you the figures and numbers. We've also consistently told departments, and it has worked, that what you do is every 3 months you assess what are the sorts of requests you're getting. And you will find that 90 to 95% of your requests fall into certain types of information. Put that type of information suo moto out in public. So that you will consistently lower your load. In fact, I feel that if a department works well, after the first year or so, the workload will go very much less because you put out all the things that people ordinarily ask for. So there'll be very few. And this is what has happened in Delhi. Now, Delhi being a city state, so to speak, people are so much more educated, this and that, awareness is much greater. Even there, and I'll show you statistics, this has not happened. But suppose it does, there can always be a provision to create another post in which you tell one person, okay, you only function as a PIO. This can be an internal arrangement. There's not such a problem. People talk about expenses, we will also deal with that. Let me tell you that if the right to information works properly, the amount of money the government will save will be many, many times what it might spend on appointing a few officers. So I don't think there's going to be a problem. There hasn't been anywhere in the world, 55 countries have a right to information act. In India, 9 states we've had, at least 4 of them have very actively pursued right to information. There's never really been a problem. And let's see if there is. Even if we need to change the act at that time, you can. There's a provision in the law that for 3 years you can make different changes to remove difficulties. So one could say that, you know, where there is a certain, where the number of queries is above a certain level, a special post can be created. Okay, the time frames, again, you all probably know, this is ordinarily 30 days, but 48 hours in the case of life and liberty cases. So this is the important thing. There are some 35, some are 40, but broadly speaking, it's a 30-day time frame that is prescribed. The time taken for calculation and intimation of fees is excluded from the time frame. So suppose somebody asks you for information, and once you collect the information, you realize that you've got to photocopy 300 pages. Now, you have to then, you see, we learned in Delhi that what would happen was that sometimes you would tell this person that, look, we've photocopied these 500 or 300 pages, now come and pay for it and take the pages. And the person wouldn't turn up, so there would be these audit objections that why did you, you know, photocopy this stuff and keep it and things like that. So now the Act has taken this into consideration. So you send that person a bill, so to speak, saying that, look, these are the number of pages, please deposit this money. And after they've deposited the money, the photocopying is done. And that time, from the time you write to the time, is not taken in your 30 days or whatever it is. So it's a way that you don't get into trouble. Then, this is interesting. No action on application for 30 days is a deemed refusal. Actually, it's not 30 days. No action on application that prescribed time is a deemed refusal. Now, why is this there? Again, learning from experience. In Maharashtra, very good act, but there was one lacuna in the act. The act said that if the public authority or the government refuses to give you some information, you can appeal against that refusal to the appellate authority, which was the Up Lokayukt. The government discovered this nice loophole, so if it was sensitive information, they just wouldn't respond. They would not reply, they would not say no, they would not say yes. And if you went to the appellate authority said, I can't do anything because you can only appeal against their order. If there is no order, then no appeal lies. So there were information which was pending for a year or 2 years. And let me tell you, this is not the only thing, and all of you, I think, or most of you work for the government. The ingenuity of the government in finding ways of getting out of giving information is enormous. So despite this act, I'm sure every government department is going to find ways and means of getting around. I'm in the Delhi State Council, and one of our responsibilities is to monitor the implementation of the act. And I got a complaint saying that there was a particular department which was making it very difficult for people to file applications. So I rang up the secretary personnel who looks after this, and I said, look, please go and have a look at what is the matter and give me a, let me know. So he came back, and he's an IAS officer, and he was laughing away. So I said, what happened? He says, you know, my colleagues are very smart, he said. He says, you know, one department was getting a lot of embarrassing queries. So they found a building which was 5 stories high. And they put the public information officer who receives application on the 5th floor. And they gave informal instructions that every day at 10 o'clock the lift should go out of order and only start functioning at 5:30 in the evening. So people went to file applications that either have to climb 5 floors or just go away. So there are many ways in which people sort of get around it. But this was one of them which we managed to put into the act. It'll also amuse you to know that I was speaking in Washington a couple of months back in the Capitol to the congressmen and telling them, the US congressmen, telling them about the Indian Act. And at this point, they were very interested because they said even the American Freedom of Information Act has this lacuna. And that there are requests which have been pending for years, which they have not been able to move because the government doesn't reply and you can't go and appeal. So they said they're going to take our act and go to President Bush and say, look, if Indians can have this clause, why can't we have it? So maybe we will finally result in improving the US Act also. This is again an interesting point, no fee for delayed response, which means that suppose somebody files an application and you are not able to give him or her the information in the time that was prescribed, you have to refund the fee, even though you might give the information. Now people said, you know, what difference does it make? It's 10 rupees. But you people work in the government, you know that if you have to refund 10 rupees even, you're going to have audit objections which are going to keep going on for the next 3 years. Why was this money had to refund? Who was responsible? Has a recovery been made, etc., etc.? So just to avoid, it's not the 10 rupees, just to avoid that audit. I've had reports where people have come, public information officers have come and offered 100 rupees personally, saying, please show that it was in 30 days so that we don't have to refund the fee. We'll give you 10 times the amount personally because we don't want to face the hassles that are going to follow. So this particular clause has been put in for that reason. There is a lot of exemptions, and I'm sure those of you who are not now yet familiar with the Act would be interested in this. Almost all the usual things are exempted. For example, anything which prejudicially affects the sovereignty and integrity of India or the security, strategic, scientific, or economic interests, relations, foreign state, etc., etc. So all the usual exemptions are there, something which is forbidden by a court of law.
Excuse me, who decides what information is privileged or affecting this?
Who decides?
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because the public information officer has to make that decision. Okay. Now, he or she might consult with his or her seniors or colleagues. But the interesting thing is that the law says, and it'll, that the onus of proving that this information is exempted rests on the person who denies the information. So it's not just enough for you to say this will affect the security of India. If the person goes on appeal, the assumption is that all information should be made public unless otherwise exempted. So you have to go and prove before the public information officer why this specific bit of information will actually be prejudicial if it's released to the security. So in that sense, the onus, there is a pressure on the public. Otherwise, it would be very simple. Anything I don't want affects the security of India. That's the end of the matter. And we realized this. And we thought a lot about this. What do we do? You know? And we found that if you put in that other clause, then the balance is there. So that you then have to go and prove. And there have been cases. There was recently two very high-profile cases, one where the Delhi Development Authority didn't want to give some information, and they were not able to prove to the Central Information Commissioner, so he said, sorry. And one was a Karnataka case where the government of, well, somebody asked for information about, you know, the government servants put in this, their assets, the list of their assets, and he wanted to know, and the government said, no, this is, we can't give you this. And the chief information of Karnataka has recently ruled that, why can't you? I mean, he's a government servant. People have a right to know what, whether he's acquired or she's acquired assets while they were in service or not. So there have been a lot of cases. And don't forget, all these information commissioners are government servants or former government servants. In fact, in India today, every single chief information commissioner is a retired IAS officer. So it's not, you know, people like me who are listening to these appeals. There are civil servants who are listening to the appeals. And yet they, because there is this clause, they say, sorry, you have not been able to make the case. Tell us what harm would be done if I know what are the assets of civil servants. So there have been many progressive sort of judgments on this, and it's very new. I mean, the law is only 3 months old, so as it evolves, you will see what happens. These are various other things. Let me come down to D. Ordinarily, commercial confidences, trade secrets, intellectual property, is exempt. But there is a caveat that it can be made public if larger public interest so warrants. Now, I remember when the discussions were going on the draft bill, one of the groups that came and discussed this was a group of young lawyers who work with HIV/AIDS patients. And they put this problem saying that drugs that are developed, the trial information, you know, when the drugs are tried, is made available to the government but not made public because the companies feel that this might help their competitors to develop drugs. However, it is very important both for the doctors and for people to develop new drugs. So couldn't we have something which would allow that? And this particular clause allows the government to weigh the pros and cons. And it can, if it decides, make this information public because it's in public interest to do so. So this is one very important clarification in the act. Received in confidence from foreign government, endangers life or physical safety or identifies confidential source of assistance. These are all exempt things. Impedes the process. And they should be exempt. I mean, you know, you can't have all these things out into the. Now, this is important. Cabinet papers are ordinarily exempt, but only till a decision is made. The moment a decision is made, cabinet papers and the basis on which that decision is made become public. Now, I know a lot of these things might traumatize us. I also worked in the government, and I know the sort of phobia surrounding cabinet papers. But if you step back and ask yourself, why? After all, I can understand that pressures come in the process of decision making, so it should be confidential. Once the decision is made, why should people not know why such a decision has been made? How will they ever be able to even judge their governments and go and cast a vote in the right place if they don't know on what basis the government makes its decisions? So I think this is an extremely important point, and which has now become a part of the law, and let us see what happens with it. Then privacy, there is a exemption for any private information. So for example, ordinarily people cannot access information about your health status, etc., etc., because that's private. So there's privacy exemption. However, this also has a public interest override, so that if some private information it is felt, it is in the public interest to make public, then it can be. For example, ordinarily, my health status might not be of public interest. But suppose you're flying an airline, you might want to know whether the pilots on that airline have good health or are they going to collapse in the middle of a flight and leave you high and dry. So that might be in public interest to know whether a particular airline has pilots who are fit. So you can have positions where even private information can be in public interest made public. Okay, this is an important clause that provided that the information which cannot be denied to the parliament or a state legislature shall not be denied to any person. So one test is that if you say no to somebody, you must be then willing to appear before the Privileges Committee of the Parliament or the Legislative Assembly and say, we will also not give it to you. Because if it's information that you have to give to Parliament or to the Legislative Assembly, then you can not deny it to an individual. So this has many advantages. One is it breaks through a lot of the barriers. Secondly, it also politically enables you to approach your MP and say, look, the government is denying me this information, which by implication means that they will not give it to you either. That gets the MP fired up. I've had this case already where a particular MLA has gone to the government and said, how dare you say you won't give it to me? And the government said, but we didn't say that. He said, you said you won't give it to him, which is the same thing as saying you won't give it to me, because the law says that you cannot deny him anything which you can not deny me. So it's a very important political fulcrum to try and push for greater transparency. And that's why I think it is a very important provision. Now, this is very important. Notwithstanding anything in the Official Secrets Act 1923, nor any of the exemptions A to I, a public authority may allow access to information if public interest in disclosure outweighs the harm to the protected interest. So in the ultimate analysis, no information is sacrosanct. The government can decide. For example, people ask me, give me an example. You can have the dump, an ammunition dump, the location of an ammunition dump is secret. You cannot, because it would, if you made it public, it would compromise the security of the country. But suppose there was a danger that there might be an earthquake in that area, and that if that earthquake took place, perhaps this dump might explode.
And so you want people to be evacuated. But they're not going to evacuate like that. So you might want to have to make it public saying that, look, you're all sitting on a huge ammunition dump. And there is now danger that there might be an earthquake and this dump might explode. And that might motivate people to move. So there can be reasons why even information which is otherwise exempt needs to be public. And the government has the right to do that. And because the government has the right to do that, we have a right as citizens to appeal. So I can go to an appellate authority and say, look, though this is exempt, I think in public interest it should be made public. And the appellate authority can then hear it. And that is the important thing about this clause. Most exempt information to be released after 20 years. So barring a few things like what affects the sovereignty, et cetera, or contempt of court or legislative privileges, all other information will be released after 20 years. So it will all become available. Of course, any information which infringes copyright except of the state is exempt. So you can't, for example, ask a library, say the NIAS library, that you please photocopy all the books you have and send me a copy under the Right to Information Act. There's not an easy way of building up your own library. So you have to, that you can't do. Where practical, part of record to be released. This is very interesting and important that we have now the principle of severability, so that you cannot refuse a whole page or a whole document just because parts of it are exempt. You'll have to black out those parts and give the rest of it, which becomes very interesting because one of the things that we found was happening in one of the state acts was that any sensitive document, they would put one thing on every document which was exempt and exempt the whole document as a result. So this severability clause has been put in for that reason. Now this is important, third party information to be released after giving notice. If I ask for information about you to the government, ordinarily that information would be covered under privacy. But if the government, for some reason or the other, feels that this should be given to me, they cannot do it without first giving you a right to be heard. So they have to tell you, look, we are proposing to make this information available. Please tell us if you have any objections. And suppose you object and they still decide to make it public, then they have to give you time to appeal. So they have to give you that space to appeal in it. So there's a fair amount of protection to private information because we didn't want this act to get used to sort of settle personal scores and things like that, things which are irrelevant otherwise. So this is very much there. Yeah. Unfortunately not, which is a very important point because we have had this problem that if you are either a government servant or if you belong to the poor sections of society, the fact that you've asked for some information can open you up to a lot of problems. There isn't because, you know, when you have an act which the basic principle is transparency, then you know you can't go the other way and say that. But if you're a government servant, don't ask for it yourself. Get somebody else to ask for it, because anybody can ask for it. You see, if you know that your boss is doing something corrupt and you want to expose it, why do you want to ask for it yourself? Get somebody in the street to ask for it.
No, I was thinking of a slightly different scenario, knowing what our pragmatic view of the land is. You mentioned that a contractor came to that guy's house. That's a very scary thing.
See, it's not scary for the following reasons. It's scary if that person was a poor person, because this does happen. I remember a battle going on Russian cards and people were threatened and beaten up. But you see, why it's not terribly scary is because suppose that contractor beats up that guy. That's an information which any one of the 100 billion people, you know, in this country can ask. Anybody can ask. You know, 1 billion population of India, anybody can ask. So by beating up one person, you're not going to stop people from asking. So it's become, but you're quite right, what we are trying to do is, we are trying to, for example, say that more and more information should be put out suo moto onto websites, so that the identity of the person who's accessing it is not obvious. But this is a lacuna. But it's very difficult to say that, you know, in a law of transparency, you must now have secrecy of the people who ask. It's difficult, though there are practical problems.
No.
Who do you send the information to?
No, you put it on your website.
That that's an interesting thing that, you know, people can ask for an information to put on the website. Our major problem is that the law says, by the way, that you cannot ask of any other information except that which is required to contact that person. Now, generally speaking, you know, we had to...
Why do you need to contact that person?
Because, you know, we have to make sure that this law is usable by people who don't have access to websites. In fact, you would be surprised, but in Rajasthan and in Delhi, and even in parts of Maharashtra, the major progressive use of this law has been by the illiterate poor people who want to know why their BPL cards, for example, they're not getting rations again.
I'm
they don't have.
I'm giving an example that if information is put out like that, then you don't need that telephone.
That is true. I think
you're
quite right. I think it's a very good idea. We should certainly try and experiment. I'll make a note of it and see if we can have a system, but it would still only cover a small part of India. Because a large number of people, rural people, don't have access to websites. So they will still have to brave the problem of asking for information and then having to suffer the ire of people whom they target. But your point is well taken. I'll certainly put it as one of the suggestions which we can consider. This particular point of intelligence security agencies...
Sir, I have a small query on the previous point.
Please, please.
When you say that when we are giving information regarding some other person, the third party, we should give a notice to the third party. Now, what is the nature of this notice? Is it just by way of informing him that his personnel, like I work in the Department of Personnel in GOK, so do we just inform him that this kind of information about you is being given, or does that third party also have a say in it, whether, you know?
Yeah, in fact, the national law provides an extra 5 days for it. It's laid down in the Act. It says that you have to, I mean, the exact language is not done, but the spirit of the Act is such that you'd have to say something to the effect that, you know, we are intending to make the following information or make it available to X or Y or Z who has asked for this for the following reasons. If you have any objections, let us know in such and such time. You then have to give those, there's time specified there. That much time has to be given to that person to file their objections. You then need to consider the objections. Suppose after considering the objections, you still feel that information can be made public. Then you have to inform him that, look, we've looked at your objections, but the government has come to a decision that this information should still be made available to that person. Now you have a right to appeal to the next person, and, you know, opportunities to be given to appeal.
That means that the PIO, for till that time, can hold on and
not give the information till the third party approaches
the appellate.
But you have to give the third party those time frames, because that's why it's now 35 days for this. So you get an extra 5 days to do this, but you have to hold on, because otherwise the whole purpose is lost. If you made it public, then the purpose is lost. So that is the idea of this. And we are hoping that it's only something which is used when, I mean, there can be sensitive information which people, at least they should be forewarned that it's being made public, you know. So that is why I think it's there.
Like, sir, working in Department of Personnel, there are a lot of issues actually which we feel cannot be put in public domain, like especially with respect to the notings made in personnel issues, say the quantum of punishment which has to be imposed after an inquiry. Now the file moves in, you know, a particular hierarchy, and everyone has its views on it. Now this is a very personal issue. If the notings are made public, it also kind of, you know, exposes the officer, and the officers may become timid in taking decisions.
You're right. In fact, the Chief Vigilance Commissioner a month and a half back requested me to come and speak to the what are they called, vigilance officers, chief vigilance officers of some of the central government departments, and they raised exactly this problem. They said, you know, you have sometimes in the vigilance department officers who belong to the same service. Now there might be an inquiry against a senior in his service. If his notings, his reports and everything became public, that senior would make sure that this junior never progressed in his or her career. So how do we solve that? So what we suggested to them is, and you remember in the exemptions that there's a clause that if somebody is conducting an inquiry on your behalf, then that information can be kept exempt. So we said you exempt the identity of the people. For example, if you are an inquiry officer who's done an inquiry, in any case, inquiry reports are made public, but suppose you've, in the process, put down certain notings or facts about somebody who's senior to you in service, okay? We suggested the Central Vigilance Commission, and we said we will certainly support this, that in those cases, in fact, we formulated a language where there can be where there's an adverse opinion or adverse sort of judgment made on some colleague, the identity of the person, if it's done as a part of your official duty, not if you, you know, just because you want to help your friend, you write something on a file again, not there. The identity of that person should be, and all that needs to be done. For example, you can retype the notes, you can make them into a different order so that you cannot identify. So we have to find solutions to that. Because in any general rule, there'll be specifics. It's very difficult to pinpoint, but we don't want a situation, which I'm sure as you work in the Department of Personnel, you would know happens very often, where if an officer is being thought of for some important position, and somebody has somebody else in mind or doesn't like this officer, then they write all sorts of unsubstantiated things on file. I have heard that this officer does not have a good reputation. And secure that this is never going to get out and that they will finish that person's chance. And I know so many cases which happens, I'm sure you know this. So we have to make sure that stops. But certainly people should be not be discouraged from writing what they really feel in cases like that. So some of these problems are, in fact, when we come to notings, we will discuss this specifically, this particular type of case. I was just telling you that in intelligence and security agencies, we had a lot of battle here because, as you know, and this has also been in the news, that many of the intelligence and security agencies wanted to be exempt. And they finally succeeded. So RAW, for example, the research and analysis wing, the IB, et cetera, are exempt. Many others who wanted to be exempt have not. For example, the armed forces. As you might have read in the newspapers, the chief of army staff even issued a circular which he had to then the next day withdraw, saying that the army doesn't come under the purview of this act. So the armed forces are under the purview of this act. Initially, many of these security agencies wanted to be exempt, and many of us from the civil society strongly objected, because our argument was that as we've already made exempt anything which impinges upon the security of the country, so that is already exempt, so why should these organizations? But unfortunately, we were not able to prevail, but the victory we got, which is important, is this one. That they are now only exempt except for allegations of corruption or allegations of human rights violation, which are the two most important things that the society is concerned about as far as these intelligence agencies go. We have people from the Northeast, people from Jammu and Kashmir coming to us and saying that, you know, these are two of the most important things. People disappear, nobody knows what's happened to them. We should have a right to find out. So these two things they're not exempt under, but they're exempt for all other things. And efforts by many other agencies to seek exemption, fortunately, I think, has not gone very far. Okay, now what is the setup? There are appeals and complaints. The first appeal is with the senior in the department. So you can appeal. Every department which has a PIO will also have an appellate, and you can appeal to the internal person. The second appeal is with the Information Commission. I think this the central government has, and many states have set up Information Commissions. So that's where the second appeal lies from. The appeal is to be disposed of between 30 and 40. They say 30 days, extendable to 45 days if reasons for delay are recorded in writing. So we don't want a system where appeals go on and on forever, so it's 30 to 45 days. Onus of proof on refuser, which is what I mentioned to you earlier, that the person, the authority which refuses, they have the onus to prove that this information should not be given. Independent central state information commissions as appellate supervisory authorities. The information commissions have been made as independent as possible. They're appointed by a committee which has the chief minister, the leader of the opposition, and our suggestion was the chief justice of the High Court of the Supreme Court. But the government didn't accept this, so it has one cabinet minister. So actually, it's 2-1 towards the government, but at least if the leader of the opposition is there, something can happen. As it is, we've only got, as I said right now, retired government servants, which to my mind is not such a bad thing, except that I just wish they weren't appointed in their own states, because that's where clash of interest comes. If you want to appoint somebody who's in Karnataka cadre as chief information, you appoint him in some other state so that he or she doesn't have to preside over issues which have taken place in their own career, because that compromises at least the appearance of objectivity. You know, so this is a big problem. We've had this problem in Delhi because we have an appellate authority. The individual who's heading that appellate authority, Mrs. Shailaja Chandra, is an excellent person with a perfect record. Nobody thinks of her as corrupt or anything, very competent. But the trouble is she was chief secretary of Delhi. Now, because I'm on the State Council, I keep getting complaints saying, well, after all, she was Chief Secretary. This happened in her time. Surely she would like to protect the officials, so she's not allowing her appeal. And even if that is not so, it creates a bad impression. I mean, you might be fair, but you don't appear to be fair, which is important. So this is my only thing. But it is truly independent because funds, for example, once they're appointed, they cannot be removed easily. You have to then go to the Supreme Court and get their opinion and then go to the president in order to remove an information commissioner. And they cannot be reappointed. They have a fixed term, either 5 years or when they reach the age of 65. And they cannot be reappointed. If an information commissioner becomes a chief information commissioner, they don't get a new tenure. It's the same 5 years which get in. So there's a lot of ways in which they've been made as independent as possible. So I don't think that is going to be a problem. And the only thing, of course, is, and of course, maybe I shouldn't say this because all of you belong to the government, but see, we had suggested a one information commission with regional people sitting regionally. And we thought that let's start with about 15 people so that you have one in Delhi and then you have, you know, people in different regions. And they were like circuit judges who would go around. But when the bill was introduced in Parliament, it had one information commissioner in each state, with up to 11 information commissioners. So this, in one go, created about 350 posts. And I don't know if you're aware, but all chief information commissioners and the central information commission is of the stature of a Supreme Court judge. And every state information commissioner is the status of a secretary to the government of India. So suddenly 350 post-retirement posts have been created. And I tongue-in-cheek say that, well, maybe if this wasn't there, the act would have never got passed. So, you know, when you sound that senior official said, well, I'm about to retire in 4 months, so if this act comes through, at least I have a post to go through. So maybe that helped us to get the act passed. Now, I'm being slightly facetious, but nevertheless, we have this. But I don't think it's such a bad thing, because I think by and large, the Information Commission seem to be functioning well. They seem to be functioning independently. And I think even the civil service will not feel wrong because it's their own people who are there. So they won't feel that there's somebody who's come who doesn't understand our constraints and problems. Just the sort of issue that you're raising is the sort of issue that a civil servant in a commission would be sensitive to and might therefore use that provision in the act which exempts people who are part of inquiries and so on and so forth to say that this, at least the identity is exempted. So this could be one of the things that helps us. The provision, now this is again very important, and I've given it as a quote from the thing. In short, this act overrides all other laws. And you must remember this, that any other law, even the Official Secrets Act, I was speaking to the Income Tax Chief Commissioner, they said, what about the Income Tax Act? I said, everything. Somebody that day contacted me and said, what about the Atomic Energy Act? Because the Atomic Energy Act has certain, you know, provisions of what can be made public and what can't. I said, this overrides it. The atomic energy secrets can get covered under other provisions in this act, you know, scientific, strategic interest, security, etc. But all those acts are overrided by this act. So this is an overriding act, and this we must keep in mind always when we deal with this law. What are the penalties? There are for unreasonable delay. Now, please remember the word unreasonable. So it is not, as some people feel, any delay and you get charged 250 rupees a day. No. It has to be unreasonable delay. If you can show that, look, there were problems, there were floods, records are missing, there was a fire, there was a curfew. There can be so many different things. It's only if you've done nothing about it. If you sat down again, I believe, am I correct? If you're from Karnataka, you'd know, has the chief commissioner of Karnataka recently fined somebody 15,000 rupees? At least I got that in the newspapers that they were so. The fine has been imposed. Not anyway, this news has been brought across that Mr. Mishra, isn't it, who's the chief, that he has fined an officer 15,000 rupees for delaying something. Maybe it happened, maybe it's not. But it is 250 rupees per day. Now, I must tell you that I had an after-lunch session with the customs officers one day. And by the time I got to this point in my presentation, they were mostly fast asleep after lunch session and so on and so forth. Then when I said, you know, 250 rupees, which will go from your salaries, they all woke up because this was a new sort of concept that will go from their salaries. And actually, this will go from the salaries of the concerned person. But, and this is again a fear which is often expressed to me, but why should the poor public information officer pay? No, we anticipated this because of what happened in Maharashtra, where they put very junior level people as public information officers. They were office superintendents or undersecretaries. And they were never able to get information for their bosses, but they'd keep getting fined. And I remember meeting one, I said, yeah, why don't you protest? He says, "Ab, theek hai, we pay the fine. At least if I protest, then I'll get a bad ACR from my boss, you know, because I'll have to say he didn't give the information, so I prefer the fine." But in this act, what it says is that if a public information officer has asked some other officer to provide information, and that officer has delayed or not provided, then it specifically says that for the purpose of penalties, that officer becomes the public information officer. So it is not just the designated PIO, but whoever blocks information who becomes. And there are, of course, other fines which go up to 25,000 rupees. Plus, if you do illegitimate refusal, et cetera, you can also be recommended for departmental action, et cetera. You'd be happy to know that when the bill was presented in Parliament in December of 2004, it had a provision that there could be up to 5 years of imprisonment if somebody destroyed information or in a malafide manner gave wrong information. But at the intervention of the Prime Minister, that clause was removed. So there is no imprisonment involved, but these things are there. Okay, so this is one part of it. There's also immunity for actions done in good faith, which means that if you are the public information officer and you make available some information, which your boss then thinks you should not have made available, they can't act against you because that is immunity for action done in good faith. Important access. It was very important that this law should not only be accessible to educated people, urban-based people, it should be accessible to people in rural areas, illiterate people. And this is where your point becomes very important because we've got to try and bring it in. First of all, it says fee at a reasonable level. It says no fee for below poverty line. Now, let me tell you that this was one progressive measure that we did not support from the civil society because our fear is that the BPL families, if they're smart, will set up a business. And they will say, anybody who wants to ask information, ask through us. Government can't charge us anything, we'll charge you half the amount. So it can really become an employment guarantee scheme, you know, that every BPL family, and this can happen as the law exists. We have suggested, now this was a populist measure that was brought in, because if you see the debates in Parliament, this was the issue that people kept raising, you know, it'll be free for BPL, free for BPL. What we have suggested is that make it free for BPL, but only for information which pertains to themselves. If they're looking for information on other matters, then let them be treated like anybody else. But I don't think that has been accepted, so that is what it is at the moment. These assistant public information officers were to be put up at sub-district levels. Now, there's been a lot of confusion about this, and I find that a lot of departments have APIOs and PIOs in the same department. That was not the idea. The idea was that at all sub-district levels, there should be one or two identified officers who are assistant public information officers, so that somebody in a village who wants to ask for information doesn't have to travel to the district or the state headquarters or maybe even go to Delhi to ask for that information. They can just give it to their local person. And the government of India has, I think, done a good thing. They have recommended that the Post and Telegraph Department function as the APIOs for all central government departments. So your local post office becomes, so if you are sitting in a village in Karnataka and you want to know something about a railway office in Chandigarh, for example, all you do is go to your village post office and give them this application, and then they get an extra 5 days and they will send it to the relevant place and get it back. State governments, we were very keen, also do the same thing, that they designate one person. It could be the BDO, it could be the Tehsildar, whatever, who becomes an APIO for all state subjects. And then you have nodal people, so that this APIO knows that, okay, I send all these applications to this nodal person who then distributes them and sorts them out. I think there has been, I don't know what Karnataka has done, but in many states there's been a lot of confusion about APIOs, so they're still not properly, yes.
In the education department, we have notified the headmasters of the schools as APIOs because parents can go to them for transfer certificates or migration certificates or...
But is it only for education department?
Yeah, of course, it's for as far as the education department is required, as concerned, the APIO is the headmaster.
Yeah, what I was suggesting for the state governments to consider, let one person be an API for all state. See, I'll tell you why. Now, let me explain why. Because what happens is the headmaster doesn't do it. Somebody has to then send it off to each department. Each group has a nodal officer. For example, there should be one nodal officer at a district level. If you have an, if you have a divisional level, then a nodal officer at divisional level, and one nodal officer at a state government level. Anything that comes from the district goes to the nodal officer. They then distribute it. Because the only problem, I'm telling you, I have this problem sitting in Delhi. I don't know which public information officer to give my, that thing. For example, Department of Personnel, Government of India has 42 public information officers. Now, when I want to give a query and they have divided up according to their heads, I don't know which one it comes under. So I have to go from desk to desk to desk, and find, and most PIOs say, look, it's not under my jurisdiction. I say, whose jurisdiction? I don't know. So you just have to go around all over. See, that they've done also. But when you talk of subjects, for example, they put it by their language. For example, they will say, all training institutes go into this, right? Now, I want to know that I had applied, or somebody had applied for a job somewhere, some training institute, and what has happened. Now, when you go to the chap who looks after training institutes, you say, I don't deal with this. This is dealt with employment, people who look at employment. Who deals with employment? I'm sorry, I don't know. I only know what I did. You know how these problems occur. So what we are trying to do is to try and... We've had another problem. I wanted to ask about something to do with cleanliness of a park. You won't believe it, this is a real case. One PIO officer says he's in charge of parks, but he's not in charge of sweepers. The other one says he's in charge of sweepers, but he's not in charge of parks. So he cannot, neither of them could take a question about cleanliness of parks, but it involves sweepers working in parks. So in the government, sometimes these things happen. So my point is that we should have a single window approach. And let the government then sort out, because it's very difficult for PIOs to sort that out. But anyway, this is out there. We also, that there is no need to specify reasons for seeking information or other personal details. Now, this has recently come up in appeal to the Central Information Commission, and I must say that Mr. Habibullah has given a very good judgment, because DDA had put a form out where it said, you please let us know why you want this information. And this person went in appeal, and the chief, yeah.
Just know what we were discussing. Like you said, the actual responsibilities, if it is not properly divided. Now, what happens there? Supposing you go to somebody, he says it's not under my purview, and another fellow says it's not my under my purview. Where do you go and end up and
submit? Finally, you just go into appeal. What we did was go to the appellate authority and say nobody is willing to accept it, which is a penal, which is a offence under section such and such of the law. So you please find out who deals with it and do it. But it's not an ideal way, but you know, because it's early days, we are saying these are teething problems.
Yes. Well, I guess you have to file another, you know, a PIL to just find out which is the person concerned for that.
Yeah, that's possible. You can file an RTI to say, who's my PIO, but that's a different matter.
Problem will be, where do you file that?
Yeah, that's a good
with
point.
The chief. With the chief.
Yeah. Even if they give less, they're going to get a complaint against them. So it'll work out slowly.
Supposing some information is asked for,
yes,
and it is already available on the website, on any website, can we just intimate them that it is,
yeah,
you can look it up on the
website? You see, the law doesn't say that, but usually it would make sense. You know, the reason why this was not put in the law is that there might be people who don't have access to the web. So all you have to do is print out those pages from the web and send it. But it would make sense that for most people who have access to the web, why should they pay the fees? Then wait for 30 days and then get it when they can access it for free immediately. So generally speaking, if people become more and more aware of the fact, so what we have suggested to PIOs is that, look, if somebody sends you an application which is already on the web, and if it is easy to do that, if they are in the rural areas or something, then send it to them. But suppose they are urban people, you can even ring them up and say, look, this is on the web. Do you still want me to process it, or you just want to go to the web, in which case I will refund your fee and take as null and void. There will be no audit objection there because you have not accepted the question. And in fact, very often if somebody goes personally, we've even suggested take 1 minute there and then and tell that person, look, you want to deposit your 10 rupees, fine, or 50 rupees or whatever it is. Otherwise, this is already on the web and it will cost you so much more because we will make photocopies and send it. So it tends to work. The reason why we've not said that because it's on the web, don't accept, is because a lot of people don't have access to the web. Secondly, people might ask for specific information. We had this problem in Delhi, where somebody wanted to know whether his ration card had been issued or not. And they said, well, the list of all the 37,000 people who've been issued ration cards is on the web, you look for it. Now, that's a different thing. You know, he wanted a specific bit of information. So we are encouraging both to go on. And I found that in I don't know what the experience in Karnataka has been, but I think in Delhi and in Maharashtra, this has worked well. And people, if they get to know it's on the web, they don't even bother to file an application.
Put the mic on.
You've been talking to government about a lot of the problems, but what about the common man? Again, unless the common man knows who to approach, governments may have it under various heads and all that. There has to be something like a PIO Karnataka, the Government of India, that's it. And someone should take it there and then route it to the appropriate PIO. You can't leave it to the common man to do.
See, that's what we are going halfway. We are not going so far as to say, let's have a PIO India and let that chap handle it. But we are going halfway. This is what I said. What we are pushing for is have a single window approach. And we are now, some ministries have done this. For example, I know in Delhi, there are some ministries where you go to the reception and they accept your form. That's it. And then they send it to whoever they have. We are trying to push. You see, if you have anything the government to do with the government, you know it takes time. And the good thing is that it takes a lot of time for bad things to get into the government, but it also takes a lot of time for good things to get into the government. So we are pushing, we are trying to say, look, there's a great advantage, do it, etc., etc. We feel that more and more when there's frustration and complaints start coming, and if some department starts receiving hundreds of complaints that we don't know who to go, then they themselves will get fed up and say, yeah, let us have a system which is user-friendly, so it'll work out. But I agree with you. I totally agree with you that that should be the principle. Very quickly, there is provision to reduce oral requests into writing. The law obligates public information officers, if somebody comes who's illiterate, cannot write, that you have to listen to them and reduce it into writing. Incidentally, the other day I was invited by the Income Tax Department in a very interesting demonstration. Apparently, the Income Tax Department, at least in Delhi, I don't know if here, has done a system where you can file complaints against the department through phones. They're now doing that for RTI, and it's wonderful because you just ring up and you say, this is the question I want to ask. And this gets recorded. And the person puts it down, types it out. Once that it's clear the question is, then they, 10 rupees, that fee, gets put onto your telephone bill. So you don't even have to go and give any. And your status goes on to the website so that you can. So it's a very good system for where telephones are. And the way that mobile phones are spreading now, for example, I mean, I believe we are adding 30 million phones a year or some absurd number like that in India. Hopefully, we'd be able to cover 40 or 50% of the population through telephone requests, which would make life much easier. And this is, the Income Tax Department has given this out to an agency, and they're doing a very good job, it seems to me. So hopefully, many other groups will take this up. There's a provision to provide all required assistance, including to sensory challenged persons. So if somebody is blind, for example, the law obligates that you get somebody who can read the documents, etc. The law says that wherever it is possible and does not divert your resources too much, provide the information that is possible in local language. So if it means translating, no, but suppose you have documents in multiple languages and people want it in local language, do. This is very important. I don't know if you're aware of this. There's a provision for damages, which says that if you illegitimately delay information or illegitimately refuse information, and this results in a loss for somebody, then they can ask the government, and the government will be obligated to make good that loss. Now, this doesn't say it'll go from your salaries, but knowing the government procedure, if it makes good, it'll probably have an internal inquiry and do recoveries, etc. So it's a very important clause that if it results in a loss, then people can ask for damages. However, the act is only applicable to citizens. Now, we protested about this a lot, not because we were interested necessarily in Pakistani nationals or anybody else getting it, but because in India, you know, most people don't have proof of citizenship. So it becomes a real harassment for them to do that. But this, for some reason, even the parliamentary committee, they did not agree to this. The only thing is that it gets, this one gets balanced out with this one. No need to specify reasons or information other than personal details. The act particularly says that you cannot ask people for any other information except that which is required to contact them. So there's a slight balancing out, and we haven't had too many, we've had no complaints so far that they're not being allowed to file because they don't have a passport, etc. But if that comes up, we'll have to do something about that because many people don't have proof of citizenship. Now, I won't go into this in very great detail, but responsibilities, there are many responsibilities of public information officers which you have to do in the first 120 days. Now, this, the last one is important, and I don't know if you're aware of this, some of you might be, but there are certain suo moto responsibilities of the government. And one of them is that it must publish all relevant facts while formulating important policies or announcing the decisions which affect public. So this is now an obligation on the government. And it is not after, it is while. So that if you are making a policy, announcing a public decision, you must say, why was this done? So this is a suo motu. You're not even waiting for people to ask. You have to do it, and it's an obligation that the government has, which I think is very important if you want to move to a participatory democracy. And also providing reasons for its administrative or quasi-judicial decisions to affected persons. This, incidentally, will help people in the government even more than people outside the government. Because now there's an obligation that every order has to be a speaking order in terms of whom it affects. That is what this means. And this is a very important clause. And as I keep telling, sometimes when officers get very disgusted and say that, look, this law is going to make a lot of problems for us, I say, you'll be surprised how many ways it will help you. How many things that you yourself will find much easier because of this particular law. There's a lot of stress on providing information. Suo motu, there's a clause saying that no information can be withheld from the Information Commission, so that you can't say it's secret, we can't show it to you. They have to look at everything in order to decide whether it should be made public or not. There is an obligation on the government to raise awareness, to educate, to train, etc., etc. And within 18 months, they're supposed to compile and then regularly update a guide to information so that people know what is the information that any department has. Now, many of these things might seem very onerous, but let me tell you that if those departments who had prepared citizens' charters, a lot of this thing was in any case required as a part of the citizens' charter. Now, it's another matter that many departments did not prepare it. Now, I come to the last bit where some of the questions you would raise, but some other questions where I go and talk to people from the government. And the sorts of questions that they raise, we've catalogued and tried to put answers across. One is, we will be overwhelmed by applications and will not be able to cope. It was a question that I think people raised. In Delhi, in almost 4 years, about 7,000 applications were received in 120 departments. Average of 1.2 per month per department. Highest number was the Municipal Corporation of Delhi, where there were 29 per month for 25 departments. MCD had 25 different PIOs, which was all about one a month. I remember 4 years back when the act came into effect, a little more than now, nearly 5 years back in Delhi, we had a first meeting of the State Council and the Chief Minister was the chairperson. And every department, head of the department, came with a list of all that they'd require, how many more staff they would require, how many computers they would require, how many cars and this, that and the other. So the Chief Minister turned to us and said, look, I don't have the money. So our suggestion was, I said, look, don't give anything right now. Let's just see how many queries do they get. Since then, we've had 10 or 11 meetings. Nobody's ever asked for anything. Because with one or two requests as an average per month, you cannot. And I'm telling you, if the act works well, this is what will happen. Because if you put out your information, suo motu, etc., each department will go to one or two or three a month, which is not going to be a terrible load.
Sir?
Yeah.
This act came into existence, effect from October 2005, isn't it?
Yeah. This is under the Delhi Act. The Delhi Act came in 2001, which is a very similar act to this one. It's only applicable in Delhi. Maharashtra had an act. Maharashtra, they said about 15,000 in 3 years. And Maharashtra is a much larger government and much less everywhere else. I was told that Karnataka, under the Karnataka Act, had much less than this. I presume that's correct. Less queries than this. And besides, as I've already mentioned, progressive suo motu disclosure will lessen pressure because more and more information you put out, there will be less and less queries. Then the RTI Act will be very costly to implement, is another objection. My first point, which is somewhat theoretical, is that if we recognize that this is a fundamental right, then this is a necessary cost. And it is a fundamental right. Can the government tomorrow say, well, protecting women is too costly, so we're going to stop protecting women, or protecting life and liberty is too costly, so we're going to stop doing that? You can't do that. It's a fundamental right. So whatever costs are involved are a part of the government. But this is a theoretical point. There are also more practical points. There are three different judgments of the Supreme Court which say that this is a fundamental right, with certain restrictions. There are three different judgments of the Supreme Court. The most famous being the one, what was his name, the fellow who filed a case against Mrs. Gandhi. That famous case about her election, I think. used to be the health minister. Rajnarayan versus the state is the most famous, where the court has specifically said this is a fundamental right. Besides, I've said already this, if the act is successful in raising accountability, then the financial and economic savings will be many times greater than the costs. Let me give you two or three examples. In Rajasthan, after this act became effective, even the skeptical civil servants told us that the drought relief work, which was the main thing in Rajasthan, corruption had gone down by 10 or 20%. In Delhi, after this was used, for example, for the public distribution system, you can go in area after area where this people start using that, and now you have no complaints of people not receiving their ration, their full quota of ration, at the proper price and reasonable quality. The government of India, I was told, spends 28,000 crores a year on the public distribution system. The Planning Commission calculated that 50% of this money does not reach the people who it should. So that means 14,000 crores. If I can less that corruption by 10%, I save 1,400 crore, which is much more than all the information commissioners will cost you every year. So actually, the costs are not an issue here. There are interesting twists to it, but even in Delhi, for example, because there's now a requirement that all contracts have to be made public, people have to know, you have to put up lists of what sanctions have come, etc. We find that ghost contracts have almost disappeared in many of the colonies. Not everywhere, but where people have got active. In the long run, the law must become a deterrent rather than a post-facto weapon. I strongly believe this, that if this law is going to continue to make us put people behind bars, then it's a failure. So it must become a deterrent. So you don't need all this. Slowly, slowly, government will start functioning in a manner in which it will be no longer people will need to access this information. This is what happened in the United States of America now, where they say that the FOIA is mainly used by commercial interests to find out who's got what contract, etc. Because systems have now become so transparent that you don't need to use the Freedom of Information Act. So slowly, slowly, it will become such. Okay, then another one is the information will be misused, officers will be blackmailed, others will be blackmailed. First thing is the RTI will only provide the truth. How can the truth be misused? It's not something which is going to provide you fiction. It's going to provide you the truth, and I don't know how that can be misused. But nevertheless, one can only be blackmailed if information is privileged. Here the information will be available to all and even put up on the web. We had a very interesting case. I don't know if there's anybody here from Pune, but the mayor of Pune and some of the councillors went on a trip around the country and spent 6-7 lakhs of rupees and came back and said it was an official trip. They had gone to examine various municipal corporations. So one of the RTI activists, who's a retired Major General, Major General Jathar, he filed a case in the court saying that this was all holidaying and it was done on public expense and this money should be recovered to them. So the mayor produced a letter in court, which purportedly had been written by her to the mayor of Delhi, saying our team is coming into Delhi, and we'd be grateful if you could depute some officers who could show them around how the corporation is working. So General Jathar sent me this letter saying, can you have it verified? I said, sure. So I put an RTI application in Delhi government saying that was such a letter received, and if it was, did such a team come? Was it shown around? What was it shown? Promptly got a reply, no such letter was received, no such team came. And this was sent back to them. And they're now having huge problems in the court. The court is asking them to recover all this money. It wants to take criminal action against them for producing false documents in court, etc. But you see, because all this was public, you know, and what we have suggested is that let's put all these things out on public. It's the sort of thing that I don't think anybody can use in this. What I did was I asked people to ask questions as and when. But if you want to, her suggestion was that we should stop and ask, have question answers.
So I have one thing.
Yeah, please.
Bioland is okay. Only thing is, you responded that when the question came, whoever is asking that information, his identity will not be disclosed. This was, suppose an anonymous letter comes. That is also is a binding to reply or give information as per those anonymous.
No, the way the law is that if it's anonymous, it will not be entertained.
It will not be.
Because the law says you have to give information.
There are cases where anonymous letters sometimes, a period has gone where we are busy in replying to anonymous letters of the Vigilance Commission.
But that's the thing. In this act, it's very clear that if it's an anonymous application, it will not be accepted. Because it says that you have to give your name and address where you can. It might be a fictitious name and address. The address will have to be correct because otherwise the letter will come back. But instead of writing your name, you can write some other name. They're not going to verify it, but anonymous will not be.
Another thing is the contracts and other things is okay. Now, as far as design is concerned, design, I tell you the thing, I mean, recently, some 2 or 3 months back, we were told to give all list of files. List of files for this purpose only. So we have given, we did not have the time to understand what type of list we should give. So whatever files we are having, I mean, thousands of file lists we have given this thing. Now, after then, of course, we have not, further reviewed that what are the exactly this thing is and what are the files we should ultimately, finally give and rest we should. Because there are a lot of any individual engineer, everybody keeps a file for these things. Certain files are duplicated also. CMM something is there, individual engineer there, his boss also keeps certain papers in file. Now, by your lecture, what I find that as far as contract related things, I am very clear that what are the things to be, recorded and files to be given. But design, I am little confused because design is a process and normally those are documented in the form of design basis report, design manuals, drawings, approved drawings, this thing. Now, before that, there are a lot of process, thousands of papers are generated, and those are not really relevant. With time, maybe in a shorter duration time, after these things are finalized, we destroy it. But these documents, design basis report, design manual, drawings, specifications, these are all documented centralized. That is enough, or can anybody question the design also? Because design, of course.
You see, you can't question a design under the Right to Information Act. And I think some of these problems will have to be worked out departmentally. For example, what does tantamount to information? If you write your own notes on a piece of paper, would that also be information? Suppose I say, in a meeting I saw him doodling on a pad, I want a copy of that doodle. Now, I don't think that's what information means. But you are quite right, some of these things will have to evolve in clarity. So I think these questions will have to be raised and answered, yeah.
Sir, nowadays the media also puts in lot of efforts and does lot of research analysis. So is there any special provision in the law?
Any?
The special provision in the law for the media.
No, media is like any other citizen. They can ask, why should they have a special that thing? Any journalist can ask for information as a citizen and get information. And they're using it. I mean, a lot of media people are using the Right to Information Act to access information and things like that. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. As I was asking, I was asked 5 years of information on various purchase orders. So to decode that information itself, the respective units have to work on overtime. And overtime amount we can transfer and then inform the party?
No, you can't under the Act. But what you should do is if you feel this is the sort of thing that people are interested in, once you processed it, put it out on the web so that nobody asks you for it again.
But 5 years of information, one has to now dig out all the files have to be seen. They said reasons for placing the order, they want it. So one has to see through all these files in 5 years. So that consumes a lot of man hours.
Yeah, unfortunately, you will have to, because it's like a policeman saying that before I catch the thief, you pay me for the time that I'm going to. So, you know, what we are taking, this is a part of the work of the
law. No, I agree. No. Onwards, it can be streamlined. But for digging out the information.
Well, let me just put a short answer is that under the law, there is no provision to put the overtime onto the person who asks for information. And one of the reasons is not is because then who's going to check what overtime is done and so on and so forth. So that provision is not there. You might ask your department.
So how to price that?
You don't have to price it. It's very simple. You just have to say how many pages there's a page. There's no pricing in the law.
Another
it's
thing.
A specific fee and photocopying charges. There's no other pricing.
The information I receive, application I receive as a public information officer.
Yeah.
I transfer it under law to some 3 or 4 persons.
Yeah.
Once they become the de facto public information officer, then do you have any role or no? I think there is no role.
Yeah, it comes back to you because you are the one who is supposed to answer.
Not that they can directly.
No, they can't. They have to go through you because you are the. But if they delay for penalty purposes, they will be punished, not you. Yeah, somebody else want to ask? Yes.
Don't you think that it can have some nuisance value to a really honest officer?
I'm not sure. In fact, we've run out of time, but our experience has been that it helps honest officers. I had, just to share with you, that when we started this in Delhi, I remember one officer telling me after 2 years, he was director of publicity or something. He says, you know, one day I got a RTI from a journalist saying, please tell us how many ads have been released by the government to what newspapers and why. So he said, I went to my minister. So minister said, yeah, you answer so many legislative assembly questions, answer this also. He says, sir, this is not a legislative assembly question. This is a RTI, we'll have a problem. So he said, minister got nervous then. He said, yeah, do something. Because everybody knew that 95% of the ads went to newspapers which the minister had identified. So he said, that time I sorted it out. I called this journalist. I told him, yeah, we'll give you some ads. Don't ask such questions, etc. But he said, from next year, the pressure went down from 95% to only 10%. I was given a free hand. So I think it helps honest officers because it exposes people. And if you're a sensible, honest person, you'll tell your boss, sir, you want me to do it? I will happily do it. But if tomorrow somebody asks under RTI, please tell me what I'm supposed to say. That will itself be a great deterrent, and we found it's actually worked. Otherwise, of course, any act can have a potential nuisance. But by and large, I feel this is an act which will help honest officers to do things which are, even in notings, I find that so many times officers' notings are overruled and bad things are done and then the officers are indicted. We found this in Delhi happening under the Jal Board, that where officers protested violently on file, but the political bosses overruled them. And the impression then was created was that all the officers were bought. Because we managed to get the notings, we were able to establish that no, the officers actually protested. It was the minister and none of the officers were vilified. So, people, you see, otherwise you have no recourse to public. You can write whatever you like on file, cannot be made public. If people can blame you, how can you get up and say, no, my minister overruled me and he's a crook? You can't say that. But now you don't have to say that. People will access it and people will say, she or he put up the right note, look what the minister did. So I think it's going to help honest officers.
Sir, can employees ask for annual appraisal reports?
Yeah, this is a question I'm often asked. I'll end with this question. Let me just simply say that as the law stands, there is no bar on asking for your annual confidential reports. But I know that the Prime Minister's office is very worried about it, and I think they're going to come up with an amendment on this. But as the law stands today, so if you want to be quick, ask for it now, they will have to provide it to you. Well, thank you very much. I think we are out of time. It was a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Singh. There will be no end to a discussion on right to information, as we saw just now. Let me invite Dr. Asanare from I-Squared IT to give a formal vote of thanks to Dr. Shekhar Singh. You to switch on the mic, please.
Were not known. In fact, I was also responsible for a private engineering college whose fees are decided by retired justice in Maharashtra now. There is a commission. And we give all information, and slowly, this is the second time, people used to show the false expenditures. Now they have started asking for the vouchers and bills and so on and so forth. And that is making the system more crystal clear, as now based on the formula we can calculate the fees on our own almost. So from this point of view, lot many things have been straightened. It's a very good act, and I'm certain the Indian administration will be much better with this act. And I think Professor Dr. Singh has clarified most of the doubt very nicely, and we are quite enlightened, satisfied. Many thanks to you, sir, on behalf of participants.
Thank you, everybody. A small memento on behalf of Director NIAS and all faculty to you, Dr. Singh.
Thank you very much.
We can have a